Hello everyone, and welcome to another episode of Stay Home, Make Pasta. I am Ben. I'm very happy to be here with you today. You are quarantined. I am quarantined. Let's make some pasta. So today we're going to start out by talking about flour. But before that, let me share with you the recipe we're going to do today. So today we're going to do a traditional Sicilian shape of macaroni, which is similar to a word that I'm sure you've heard all the time, macaroni. Macaroni generally means a hollow tube, and that's been adapted into Italian-American dialect to refer to pasta in general in a lot of ways. Macaroni and cheese, those elbows became the iconic macaroni shape. But when we talk macaroni, we're talking a hollow tube. So I'll describe more about the dish. It's going to be a macaroni in a simple pomodoro sauce with basil, pomodoro, basilico, and we're going to finish it off with a little ricotta. So back to flour, because this dish is all about highlighting the taste of the pasta itself. That's what I'm aiming for here, is really deep flavor in the actual pasta noodles. So flour. For this dish, I've used a bolted hard wheat from Castle Valley Mill in Pennsylvania, thanks to Chris Arison for the flour hookup. That flour is kind of like between your regular soft bleached flour and, or not necessarily bleached, but your regular white flour and a whole wheat flour, somewhere in the middle. And I've mixed that, about 3/4 of that, with 1/4 of our 00 pasta flour, just to soften it a little bit, add a little more elasticity and pliability to it so that it's a little more workable. But let's talk about flour, because flour is really where the flavor of your pasta noodles comes from. And we are generally used to flour that's been around for a while. And during these times, any flour you have is going to be absolutely perfect. But to talk through a little bit of what your options are beyond your all-purpose flour that's probably sitting around on the shelf, there are a lot of different flours that we can work with. So generally for our pastas, we use OO pasta flour, which is extremely soft and ends up creating a really silky pasta. And there are a couple different brands of OO. And we also use this semolina flour, durum wheat, and Bob's Red Mill is one that we use all the time. Really great product, available in most stores. This gives you a heartier, bitier pasta. It's great for extruded pastas, often seen more towards the south of Italy, so southern Italian pastas, you're gonna see a lot of that. And that's the universe that we generally work in here in your average home kitchen. You're maybe gonna be using all-purpose. If you're not, and you're looking for something a little more particular, you're going to be using OO or durum, but that just scratches the surface of flours that are available. And there's some really wonderful mills in our area that you can check out, and Castle Valley Mill is a really great one that ships into the city and the surrounding areas. I picked up 2 really exciting bags of flour from Gustiamo, which is a great Italian import site, and these 2 are heritage flours from Sicily. So as I said in my last video, we were planning to go to Sicily this summer. That's not going to happen. So we're trying to support local Sicilian merchants and buy the products we would have bought had we been there. So these are really wonderful flours. We're going to be experimenting with them in different videos. But this all comes back to the fact that freshly milled flour is your best source of flavor in your pasta noodles. So while it's certainly fine to use flour that's been sitting on the shelf for a while, you're gonna lose out on some of the flavor you can achieve with fresher, freshly milled flour. It's definitely a luxury, but it's not as hard to come by, and it's not really as, maybe calling it a luxury is a bit of an exaggeration. It's an extra step, but it's not that expensive, it's not that hard to come by, and it imparts a lot of great flavor. So today, as I said, we're doing macaroni. I made a dough here that is, as I said, 75% Castle Valley and 25% OO right out of the bag. And it creates this beautiful, I'll show you up close, kind of speckled brownish dough, which is going to be really great to work with. So I'm going to bring you closer to the board and show you how we're going to make this macaroni shape now for our macaroni, pomodoro, basilico, And then after we roll out a bunch of those, we'll let them dry, and we'll move on to our condimento and talk a little bit how we bring that together. Okay, so I've got you down close to the board now. All you're going to need in order to make this pasta shape is your beautiful dough. Again, with this dough, and I'll refer you back to our first video where we talked about doughs that are just flour and water. This we worked for quite some time. We let it rest for a while for that gluten to develop during both the kneading and resting steps. And now it's great and pliable and easy to work with. It's got a good bounce to it. And that wouldn't be the case if we didn't work it enough. So this requires some hard work. I had to put some elbow grease into this one. So all that you need for tools is a knife to cut off chunks of this, and a ferro, a rod. And like we said during that first video, a chopstick. In Italy, people use spokes off of an umbrella or a bicycle wheel, or really a pencil, anything you find that can be rod-like is what you're going to use here. So let me show you how we make this shape. So I'm going to cut off just a tiny little piece. And I use this knife, this cleaver, because it's pretty flat. That prevents you from squeezing and being tempted to squeeze down into the dough as you cut it, which would smush and is not good. I'm going to find something to cover this guy with just to keep it moist. You know, we'll use my clean towel. And you don't want it to dry out, so that's why we're going to do that. So then this piece, I'm going to roll out into probably two pieces that are about the size of my pinky. My board is just very lightly floured. So two pinky-sized pieces that I'm going to cut right in half. And with these, I'm going to place my ferro, my rod, right in the middle of it. And I'm going to kind of pinch it together so that it starts to stick together. And then I'm going to roll it, pressing down into it to make sure it sticks. And I'm going to try to keep it together as I expand it across the rod. And that's going to give us, when I pull it off here, a hollow tube of macaroni. Now this is kind of a longer piece, but that's how I want them for this dish. I want some longer pieces where it's a bit dramatic that you've got this long hand-rolled tube. We're going to let it dry out for maybe a couple hours. And it's just flour and water, so it can sit out and dry out. And that, I think, is going to have a really nice bite to it, especially with this harder wheat. So to show you again, we pinch it around the tube, and then we press and roll it out, pressing down and out at the same time, and working to try to keep it together and to seal that seam. Alright, then once it comes together, we twist it off, and we have a nice long macaron. So that's what we're going to do today. I'm going to do a whole bunch of these, and then when we come back, we'll take a look at what we've made and start talking about our simple pomodoro sauce, which will hopefully highlight this lovely wheat that we've got in this dough. It's about an hour later, and we have this beautiful set of macaroni. Now, some are more beautiful than others, but overall, they've held up their shape. I'll show you an example where the tube runs all the way through. And we tested some of these out. They're pretty delicious. So we're going to let everything hang out and dry for a couple hours. You could eat these right away, but we're going to let them dry for a couple hours just to firm up a little bit, get a little more bite to them. And then we will switch over and start to focus on our condimento. All right, so our pasta's been drying out for about 2 hours, and now we have these beautiful wheat pasta. Just the color of the pasta here is incredible, that dark color from the freshly ground wheat. So this is what we're going to be doing today. This is enough for 3 meals. So we're going to do our meal tonight and then whatever's left over. Now for the sauce. So in our pan, we've got a decent amount of olive oil, a little bit of hot pepper, and we're going to do a simple pomodoro and basilico and basil. Basil's looking a little weak, but we'll find the good pieces. So this is a sauce, super simple, really meant to highlight the pasta itself. Just add that acidity, add the sweetness, and the herbal quality of the basil. So what we're basically going to do is fry the tomatoes in the olive oil. So we have San Marzano tomatoes whole. Really good always to buy whole canned tomatoes, because when they're crushed up, they're exposed to more preservatives. You get kind of a funky, tinny flavor to them that you want to avoid. So buying whole peeled tomatoes is the way to go. We have these beautiful cherry tomatoes from our butcher that we're going to throw in as well. You could put those in hot water and peel them, but that's a headache. We're not going to do that. Garlic, I took out the stem from the middle of the garlic, and this garlic we're just going to add, yeah, you can see the little hole there where I pulled that out. We're just going to add in whole for our olive oil, and we're going to pull that out later. So we're just adding this in for aromatic quality, for that type of flavor. And wine break. And we have our pasta water boiling, which we always do because you don't want to lose the rhythm of your cooking and get to the point where you're ready to add your pasta in and you don't have any boiling pasta water. So we've got that going. This is getting to a good temperature here. I want it to have a little sizzle to it before I throw in the tomatoes. And if you see, the garlic's just starting to bubble. So that tells me we're getting right to about the temperature where I want this to be. I'm gonna let the garlic brown just a touch. Okay. So this was a really fun pasta to make. It took a little time, and getting these off the dowels was a bit of a trick, but they've held up their shape, and I think they're going to hold up as a tube, as a real macaroni. So that's going to be delicious with this sauce that'll run through them. And we're going to finish this tonight with a little scoop of ricotta on top, just to cause a bit of creaminess to this very acidic tomato sauce, which is going to be a nice way to bring it all together at the end. Show you how to do that. All right, so garlic is moving along, almost there. We have one hot pepper, some peperoncino in there, just for a little bit of heat. Again, the garlic, the pepper, none of this is overwhelming. None of this is smack in your face garlic, hot pepper. It's to add layers of flavor, a bit of complexity, and flavor the oil that's going to flow through all of the tomatoes. So that's the idea with this tomato sauce. Oftentimes you'll find when you just add tomato without really cooking it or imparting this kind of emulsification to it with the olive oil, it just tastes like raw, acidy tomato, which is not the best. So what we're trying to do with the sauce is cook the tomato, impart these garlicky, spicy flavors to it, and then that will flow throughout everything. So we're about ready. It's going to sputter everywhere. So here we go. We're going to put this in. That's what we're looking for. And then we're also, it's a really, you know, the oil got pretty hot, which is exactly what we want. And we're going to add these gorgeous cherry tomatoes. And move that all around. And you can see already around the edges, the oil's starting to fry. See right there? The tomato. And that's what we want. We want this a fair amount of oil. It's one can of tomatoes and then one container of the cherry tomatoes. That's what we want. I'm going to remove now those big chunks of hot pepper. Because again, we don't want a ton of those. And that kind of did its business. And now we're going to let this simmer for about, oh, I'd say maybe 7 to 10 minutes.
Bless you.
And then we're going to be good to add our pasta. All right, so here I've got everything set up for when we're ready to finish. So we got our plates to receive things, some basil for garnishing, pecorino for grating on top, the ricotta that we talked about. We're just going to do a spoonful of that on top, some finishing salt, and our finishing olive oil. So everything's set up, so everything will come together really well once this is all finished. So if you come in here, our tomatoes have been frying in our olive oil for maybe 5-7 minutes. And they're looking really great. I've added some salt and pepper to that. Our water is boiling, so I'm going to put the pasta in right now. I also have my basil ready, and the basil is going to go in a big handful once the pasta is in with the tomato, so that it incorporates together, but not so early that it fries off or cooks off and all the flavor kind of disappears. All right, so we've got our salted water. Again, salted like a good soup, not like the ocean. That's too much. And we're going to go pasta in. And as soon as I get it in, I give it a quick twirl just to make sure nothing sticks.
And then I'm gonna retrieve our lid and put the lid back on just to try to get it back to boiling really quickly. Because otherwise it won't cook as evenly. You'll get a bit of chewiness to it. We don't want that. So we're gonna take a look at this here, which is looking really great. I see that garlic, I'm gonna take that out. This is a really lovely, simple condimento. You know, last week we did something a little more complex with that pesto alla trapanese, and thanks very much to Naomi and Kapil, who are the ones who brought us those beautiful Sicilian almonds we used last week. They were fantastic. This week, something much simpler, just a light tomato sauce. And as long as you use good ingredients and you cook things the right way, it'll come together beautifully. So I'm just going to give this a little test. Really nice. Really nice tomato flavor. I'm going to add a little bit of salt to it, but not too much, because A, I can salt it later, and B, there's salt in my pasta water. So when I add pasta water and when I add the pasta, this is going to get salt added to it as well. So as you want to be thinking about your seasoning, tasting, testing throughout the whole process so you know what you need to add when. And you can always adjust. All right, this is back to a boil. And most of the pasta, as you can see, has started to rise to the top already and expand and become, look at these, they're beautiful. They're become fatter and they still hold their tube shape, which is pretty wonderful. There they are, macaroni. So as they come to the top, I'm gonna give them a little bit more, but not too much more. I'm gonna kill the heat, and I'm gonna start scooping them off right into our sauce. And we wanna take some of this pasta water right on with us. Not a ton of it, but a decent amount. We'll probably add a little more. You can see, again, that beautiful wheat imparts a beautiful color to these that you're not gonna get from your average pasta flour. That looks like all of them. We're going to save our water, because we're almost certainly going to add some more. And this, we're going to start to flip just a little bit. Not crazy. We're going to stir it around like this, which is, you know, the flipping is it can be effective, but it's not necessary. We're just trying to incorporate the pasta with the sauce and make the pasta and the sauce become one. And that's the goal here, that they're not separate things. And it looks like we have a lot of sauce here. We're not going to end up using all of it. We'll save some of it off the side. That's perfect for what we need right now. So we're going to let that cook together. I am going to add a little bit of pasta water here. Just a little bit to help create that starchy consistency that we're looking for. Here, really let that cook together. And in a bit, I'm gonna add the basil. I'm not gonna forget about the basil. I'm like, I don't forget about basil. Delicious, fresh tomato. A little bit more salt, a little bit of pepper. All right. And this is coming together beautifully. So I am now going to toss in that basil. One big handful of basil. And just toss that through. It'll wilt immediately. And we get this gorgeous classic Italian colors. I'm just being gentle because I don't want to break this pasta that we put so much time into creating. I don't want to break it up. That's why I'm kind of folding from the bottom and just folding it up on top of itself. That's all I'm doing here. Very gentle. I have this on pretty high heat because I do want them to cook together some, to get to know each other. For the sauce to run through the noodle. That's what we're looking for. And we are just about there. So I'm gonna test this once more. Yeah, it's really nice. The basil's run through it. Look at these gorgeous noodles. I'm going to kill the heat. I'm going to come over to my dish. And I'm going to put a nice, generous couple spoonfuls right in the center. Right like that. A couple. Probably meant more than a couple. That's perfect. Right like that. Here, I'm going to clean off my dish. Just a little bit. And now I've got everything ready here, so I'm ready to go. I'm going to add first a spoonful of ricotta. Just right on top, like that. I'm going to hit it with a little bit of finishing salt. I'm going to hit it with a little bit of finishing olive oil. I'm going to hit it with a little bit of pecorino romano. And finally, I'm going to finish it with a couple basil leaves, because why not? And there is macaroni pomodoro basilico, and that's dinner. There it is with everything mixed in. Oh my gosh, you should make this. It's delicious!